Hello, everyone, and welcome to Code with Italians, or way. Today, we have two returning guests. You might have heard of them. Jake in the upper right corner and Leland in the lower right corner. Sounds like a contestant for like a boxing match or something. But no, we're here to talk about Compose internals today with the right people, I guess. I don't know. So thank you both for being back. Really appreciate it. There's someone in the chat is already mentioning Flutter. I don't know who that person is, but
never heard of him.
Ivan, all yours.
Us and thank you for supporting us. Ways to support us: you can subscribe to the Twitch channel, you can pay, or you can make Bezos pay, because if you have an Amazon Prime subscription, you can connect it to your Twitch account and you can subscribe for free to a Twitch channel for 1 month. So it's not just rockets, it's also channels on Twitch. That's good. Ciao, grazie, Bezos. From a more like involved point of view, we have a coffee page, and you can donate or subscribe to the channel. We have a lot of tiers. You get access to our Discord channel. You get access to our source code for non-public repos. There's a lot of stuff that you can check out, and it comes for like any price, whatever you want to support. And today we are gonna run the usual stickers giveaway, so stick with us. Did you see what I did there? Sticker. Well, whatever. I'm wasting my time with you. Anyway, so if you are a subscriber, you get the holo sticker. If you are not a subscriber, shame on you. You just get the normal sticker. and we get also a bunch of stickers from JetBrains, because Sebastiano knows people at JetBrains.
Yeah.
And that's it. Good to go. Thank you for having. The chat is actually very active at the moment, so keep putting your questions either on the chat or on Slido. Everything is a fair game.
Thank you, Jake, for the
thank
sub.
Thank you for the
You're
sub.
Forgiven for the Flutter. For the Flutter joke. I just wanted to say before we start one last thing. Super, super proud. Thank you, everyone. We got to 1,000 subscribers on YouTube yesterday. That's amazing. Thank you. So, yes, I'm done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oof. It's a very, very, very nice. So, where do we want to start, Sebastiano?
Well, let's start with Jake and Leland. Do you have anything in particular you want to start from, or shall we get started with the questions?
I've been thinking about what I had mentioned to you when we were sort of setting up this call a week ago, where you had Chet and Rahman on, and Rahman built this toolkit with a bunch of limitations, but you know, demoing sort of what's possible. And one of the things that came out of it was it basically re-rendered every frame.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's sort of one of the things that there's a lot of things in the Compose runtime and internals that people sort of are just unaware of, because if you're using Compose UI, a lot of this stuff just happens automatically. But I think a good place to start is teeing off of that, where the way that Compose UI, like the entry point into both Compose UI and anything Compose based, when it knows when to actually perform, like try and do work and detect changes. And so Rahman's code, you know, was just basically doing everything on every frame hooked into Choreographer. And then every frame, it was basically doing the entirety of work. But Compose actually sort of does the exact same thing, where it hooks into Choreographer and on every frame looks to see whether it has to do work. And I thought that would be like a good entry point and segue from sort of a previous episode to show what the actual new UI toolkit is doing to solve that problem of how it A, how it hooks up, you know, gets like that signal to know when to do something. And then B, how it solves the problem that Ramon didn't solve, which was how to basically not do work when there's nothing to do.
Yeah, sure. I like that.
I just want to say, I mean, we were live. He was doing it live. So it's not that, oh, yeah, he didn't solve it. it was a bit harder than that. But yeah, I'm just kidding.
Every once in a while, he needs to prove to everyone that he can still code, you know, it's like those manager hands.
Oh.
Not even here to defend himself.
Yeah, well, I'm clarifying that he can in fact still code. So, yeah, no, that was a really cool episode, and yeah, I like the idea of bridging the limitations that had versus what we have with Compose, and like, you know, what's the difference, what's the gap, and how do we fill it? I mean, so one of the things that I guess is kind of similar. I didn't look very fine-grained at the code that Romana written, but so we do use the choreographer. I feel like one thing that a lot of people miss is that Compose batches work. So, you know, essentially every frame, the frame in the sense of the choreographer frame, you know, in between frames, things might happen, right? So data might get mutated, what will happen is if you mutate most common situation is like you mutate a mutable state object. There are other ways to trigger invalidations, but mutable state objects, what they do is when they get invalidated, they go and they find they basically have access to information as far as which scopes read that mutable state object during the previous composition. And so what it'll do is it'll go and invalidate those scopes. And if this is happening outside of a composition, all that does really is just schedule work for later. And so just kind of like marks this scope as invalid. And then whenever the next frame happens, from the very top level of the composition, we look at the hierarchy. And this is like the hierarchy from the point of view of the Compose runtime. So this is a pretty deep hierarchy. It's like all of your composables. It's not necessarily, I mean, it includes all of the layout nodes, which is like you can think of it as analogous to the view tree. But it also includes all of the groups that composable functions create, because those are the things that end up being what we call the recompose scopes. And so it'll start at the top, and you know, it'll essentially do a depth first traversal of the entire hierarchy, but it's a bit of a smart traversal. So like it'll do depth first order, but it won't necessarily visit every single node. What it'll do is it'll basically kind of understand where the invalidations in the tree take place, and it'll kind of visit them one by one. And when it finds an invalidated scope, which is one of the scopes that a mutable state was read in that ended up getting mutated, basically, what happens is the runtime knows how to re-execute that composable function. And the way it knows how to do that is because the Compose compiler generates code that allows it to do that, or that, you know, teaches the runtime how to do that, so to speak. So basically there's a lambda that re-executes the function with the right arguments. And so then that happens. And potentially as a result of that, so you're re-executing this function, and you're re-executing it because something changed. So some, you know, state object has a different value than it did before. And because of that, you're probably going to compose something different. You know, maybe that's like, you know, a padding value got changed. You know, maybe some string that was passed into a text node got updated. Or it could be something, you know, much bigger than that. Maybe you loaded this huge piece of data from the internet, from some API or something. And now all of a sudden you went from loading a little progress spinner to loading and rendering like a whole UI, right? And so that's like a huge change. And so, you know, whatever the spectrum of that is, it'll start executing that function. And when it goes to call into other functions, which is like the child hierarchy of that recompose scope, Compose does some unique things, which is that it's able to detect when arguments to certain functions are the same as they were the previous time. And in that case, actually just skip the execution of that function altogether. Even though it looks like it's kind of running the whole function, it's sort of just running a shallow version of that function, except for when the arguments changed. And so that's when it'll sort of dive in. And as it's doing this, if it skips over a big like function call, it can't just, skip and go to next. What it has to do is it has to understand, were there any other invalidated recompose scopes that were actually part of that call? And if there were, then it actually goes in and executes those before it fully skips over. And so you're sort of like doing this like patchy update of the entire hierarchy, which, you know, in many cases you want to be very fast because maybe you're actually recomposing as a result of an animation. And so you're doing this every single frame. And other times, you know, it's going to take longer just because you're actually generating like an entire new UI. And so that, like all those capabilities that I just mentioned, those are the things that like you can't easily do without something like the Compose compiler, which generates a lot of kind of information. It gives the runtime enough information to do all this without you, the developer, having to kind of write a whole bunch of extra code to manage that. And that was sort of from like the very, very beginning, that was kind of like our true north of what we wanted to sort of build, was something where, we were creating something where you could write it as if you're re-rendering the whole thing every time. And so sort of like Roma's runtime. But in actuality, what was happening was writing that code in that way, we were generating enough extra information such that whenever it came to update things, we were able to do much less work. And that was kind of the whole game, was to figure out how to do that well without making the developer experience like super weird and kooky. I personally feel like we executed on that pretty well, but that's also a subjective thing. I don't know. I just rambled a whole bunch. Let me know if that made any sense.
It did. Yeah, like, sorry, go ahead, Jake.
I was just going to say, I like how you compare layout node to what is essentially a view in the old view tree. Because there's like a shocking amount of common concepts between the two UI toolkits. Because the old UI toolkit is basically doing the same thing, where it's getting callbacks every frame and determining whether or not it has to do any work. But the mechanisms by which it's doing that are much more coarsely grained through like basically invalidation. Whereas Compose turns that into real granular mechanisms. And not only that, but when a granular element is invalidated, the way by which it can do the minimal amount of work necessary is much more powerful as well, because of sort of the separation of, or really like the power of the compiler going in and inserting these various almost hooks into like the slot table, where you really only need to find what is the minimal amount of work that needs to be recomposed and to do that. It's like, it's really, I really like drawing the comparison, because as much as this is a, UI toolkit written from scratch, there's a lot of concepts that map almost one-to-one with not only our old Android UI toolkit, but one that Ramon whipped up, or even UI toolkits that are on other platforms as well.
Ivan, you had a question?
Yes, I wrote it in the chat. Slot table? I was like, yeah, huh? I was, and then now because the slot table.
Did I say slot table?
Yeah, you did.
I was trying to avoid using Jake. That word, but
Jake said it.
Okay, Jake said it.
It's like the engine that powers Compose, and you have a person that worked intimately with it that can probably explain it extremely well.
What is interesting? I mean, the slot table, it's become my mental model for like how everything works, but it is still for the most part an implementation detail. We actually, the very first version of Compose had a different implementation that didn't work at all like the slot table, but the overall experience is the same. But we made this shift to the slot table as under the assumption that the long term performance was going to be better with this type of data structure. But basically, whenever you use Compose, there's a lot of information that the runtime needs to hold on to. And so some of that happens automatically. Like I mentioned, that we detect if parameters have changed between function calls, between the last time and the current execution. And the only way we can do that is by holding on to what the values were the previous time. And so the slot table is essentially where we hold on to that data. But it's also like, so that's sort of a case where it happens automatically. But anytime you use the function remember, what that's doing is basically addressing the slot table directly. It's addressing this sort of cache of data that you have available to you, so that you can save values across executions of the function, which isn't a behavior or a capability that functions normally have, right? Like once the function exits, the stack's gone. Like, I mean, there's no memory that it's taking up after the fact. And so that's one of the like very stark differences between a composable function and a normal function. So the slot table is just where we hold that information, and it has, it's built in a very specific way to make doing all of the things we need to do as efficient as possible. But the first implementation of the runtime, that I wrote had, it was like much more of typical, sort of design where it was just a tree, basically, a linked list, if you want, of, different nodes. And so we had, we essentially built up a tree. The slot table is like much more similar to, I guess, if you think of the same tree, semantically, it's sort of stored as like almost like a heap like data structure where it's held in like a very large array. And actually now it's held in multiple arrays. So we actually have an array that's an int array, and then we have a separate array that's like an array of any. And the reason we do that is because it turns out that like to do the things we need to do, there's a lot of integers flowing around. And it's just advantageous for us to think of it as two arrays that are split up, because we can then do some micro optimizations around addressing all the integers, it's the data structure that we use to sort of back the runtime. For those that are kind of interested in these types of things, it's a lot of like the primary interface of it. It looks a lot like a gap buffer, which is a way to take a data structure that maps onto a collection of things. And you can have very efficient update operations, but you pay like kind of a one-time cost. And so if you're updating a lot in like one location at like the same time, then it ends up being a really good trade-off. And for UIs, that's often what we're doing. So we're often removing a big chunk of UI or adding a big new chunk of UI in, or we're not changing the overall shape of the UI. And because of those characteristics, this ended up, we thought, being a really good fit for what we're doing.
Thanks.
Cool.
Would I find more of these things in Jorge's book? Because I remember that you helped with the book, right? You wrote a chapter, right? The Compose Internals. How was it?
I'm just making sure you're still talking to me.
Yeah.
Yes. Sorry.
I didn't write a chapter. I reviewed some work that Jorge had done and made sure that it was, you know, accurate. And so I gave him some feedback on some things, but that's it. I didn't write the whole chapter or anything. And I don't know if it has that. I think it talks about it. I'm not sure what level of detail it goes in to the types of things that we just discussed. But
yeah, that link. So you guys pasted one of Leland's blog posts in the chat. The book actually links out to that blog post as sort of the canonical reference for what the slot table is and how it works.
But it also
does cause it. Yeah.
I need to make sure my website stays up now.
It's a medium. It should be all right.
Sorry, I interrupted, Jake.
As long as you visit it today and not yesterday, it's probably up.
Wait, was it hosted on US East?
It was everything hosted there.
Yeah, actually, it probably was.
Ouch. Yeah, I linked to the version on the Android developers medium. So I think you don't need to care too much about the bandwidth, Leland, but it should be all right. I was thinking, should we start taking some of the questions from the Slido? I think most of the ones that have been asked in the chat have also been asked on the Slido. And since we get upvotes there, it probably makes more sense to start from that one. And maybe first one from Atul. Will there be any difference in scrolling or any motion on user gestures between view world and compose world? If not, how is the same behavior maintained between these two?
Yeah, that's a good question. So gestures, it really depends on the specific thing. So like, for instance, certain things use like the platform implementations, if like it's convenient or makes sense and it's possible. Like for instance, there's a new there's like a new overscroll behavior that that actually uses a shader that's like built into Android 12 or whatever it is. And so we actually, you know, just call directly out to it. And it's like similar for, you know, like the new like glow effect and the old ripple effect and things like that. Like I think for all of those, we're using the actual shader that the platform's using. And so like there's no way for it to be different because we're using the same thing. There are other things where we actually re-implement something to the same spec. And I think some of the scroll physics are probably in that category. And then like, what else would there be? So yeah, it just depends. So I don't know if that answers your question. Like, I guess the answer is it's possible, just depends which thing. Sometimes we use the platform thing, sometimes we don't. It depends how easily usable it is.
Like ripples come to mind for like a re-implement.
Well, we re-implemented ripples, but we also used the ripple drawable, I think, when possible. So it's like we kind of did both there. I don't remember why.
I think I've seen the sparkles on Android 12, so I would imagine you either re-implemented it entirely, including the sparkles, or just using the platform.
So the sparkles uses the shader in the platform. We didn't re-implement that, but I do think that we like attempted to re-implement ripple like in code, but I think we ended up with both, maybe depending on which one's there. So like maybe, I don't know this for sure, but I think maybe if you're using like Compose Desktop, there's still ripples there, and that probably uses the re-implementation. But then, like, if you're on an Android device, it probably used Ripple Drawable. That would be my guess. I know originally it did not use the Ripple Drawable, but I'm pretty sure that that happened at some point.
Got it. Let's switch to another question. Next up, most upvoted, is the main question is, did Jake learn the UI part of Compose?
No, I have done zero. Zero Compose UI.
Zero.
since our last meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
Let's move really on. Cool. Let's like move on.
No. Let's stay here. because I actually love that someone like Jake is really pushing the bounds of like what, you know, Compose can be used for and like really thinking about these things. Cause there are things that like I've thought about from time to time, but yeah, I'm not going to do them in like my copious amounts of free time. And so it's really cool. Like the new state thing, I'm sorry, I forget the name.
Molecule.
Yeah. I've been, so, you know, a long time ago, there was a point where I forget when it was, like, so as we were evolving what the compiler did, what the runtime did, all these things, there, like, things kind of started getting simpler and simpler. I know based on my previous, like, three answers that sounds impossible, but, there were certain things about emitting layout nodes into like the, or like, so we, you know, like any type of node, like, so whatever the composition hierarchy targets, there's like a, you know, a tree type. And so emitting those things, we call it like an emit. Although now I think the composable, it's like called composable node or something, compose node. That used to be something that the compiler knew about, was like, so there was like composable calls and then there was composable emits and they were like two separate things. And then we simplified things to where an emit like wasn't anything. It was just something that we wrote in code. And so the compiler didn't need to understand it. And then like, as soon as that happened, my like first thought was like, we don't need a tree like at all. Like, I mean, there's no reason for a tree to be like a thing that the composition like creates, like, you know, the composition like builds and maintains a tree for the most part, but like, it doesn't need to. And so like, there's actually useful functionality in everything minus, you know, the tree maintenance. And so I remember like talking to Chuck and I was like, let's get rid of the tree as like an inherent property of the composition. And we kind of went a little bit in that direction, but it's still not really there. And so I think Molecule uses like a unit applier or something. Like technically technically Molecule is maintaining a tree of unit objects.
But right. Like, yeah, we initialize it with unit and it never, we never get mutations to the tree. Nothing's ever added, yeah, removed. Like we get, yeah, no callbacks because we never, right, call. We don't have any compose node calls to produce any
I'm
nodes.
Really glad that you did that because what that means is that someone else besides me like thought that was a good idea and thought that that's how it should work. And like, and that, so that shows some use cases, right, that aren't fabricated in my brain. And so, like I, you know, I hope that we continue separating that more than it is right now. Also because I think if like eventually this whole idea of composable functions and stuff like that, if that is to make it as like a language feature, I think that's probably what it'll look like. It won't be maintaining a tree. That'll just be something extra that we could add on top of it, somehow. But yeah, so anyway, I just wanted to say that I'm glad that Jake is, you know, building his own inventions on top of Compose and that someone is doing that because that's continuing to make people think about what else it could be used for.
I promise I will eventually try Compose by though. It's more that I'm not worried about, like, I don't feel an overwhelming need to learn it, because I feel like it's in a really good state. And, you know, I know a little bit of it, of how it works and stuff, just from having to look through it to figure out how to build other things on top of Compose. And I'm confident that, like, it's not something where I feel the need to learn it immediately and I'm going to be left behind. We're certainly investing a lot in it at work. I'm just not at that layer. And so, someday I'll put some pixels on screen with it, but, yeah, not yet.
I mean, I also don't use it as much as I wish I did. Like, you know, when I do live streams and I'm like building apps and stuff, like you're not watching like a seasoned, you know, Compose UI developer. You're watching, you know, someone who helped build the thing, but like doesn't actually spend a lot of time day to day building things with it. And that's why I do it, is because I want to have that experience. But like, you know, most of my knowledge comes from like just reviewing CLs and stuff, and not from actually writing code with it. And I think that's unfortunate, which is why I try really hard to spend time doing those things.
Got it.
We pretty much do the same.
Yeah.
apart from having an idea what's under the hood, the we don't know what we are doing part, that's, we are nailing it. So
we're all in the same boat. Yeah.
I mean, I would argue that's all software development is. You're trying to do something, you don't know how to do it, and you bash your hand against it until you manage to do it or give up. Yeah. If it's a hobby project, well, then I mean, maybe more of the latter. I don't know.
Usually I don't have like people trolling me in the chat when I work. So
it's still a, you know, it's still a like caring, showing that they're caring. So, uh-huh, uh-huh. So I take it as a support.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Next question.
Another question, Sebastian.
When Compose multi-platform for iOS? I don't think anyone here can answer that.
Yeah.
I mean, I can answer that.
Whenever you're done building it.
You can already do this. You just can't do Compose UI on iOS.
Fair enough.
Fair?
Yeah, I guess Compose UI for iOS. So the political answer, I work at JetBrains, so I'm technically the person that knows the most about it, and I don't know anything about it. So the only answer I have is, I guess they know people want it, and if they can, they'll make it? ? That's the best I can give you, I'm afraid. But yeah, I know people ask for that all the time, and I know the team knows that people ask for that all the time. But I don't know anything beyond that, honestly, I'm afraid. So sorry if I didn't give you a better answer than that.
Think about it as another half-assed thing that they are gonna call Compose multi-platform. It's everything inside.
Hey! Let's be nice.
Just kidding. Come on. Just kidding.
I mean, you know very well that Compose Web is a young creature. So don't pick on Compose Web.
No. I'm happy to have people working on things. So. That's for sure.
So the next question, and I guess this is for Jake, if Jake were on the Compose team, what would be the one thing he'd like to change? You cannot say Leland or Roman because they're here.
Or yeah. the package name. You can't. That's
all. Well, package name is fine.
Okay.
No, I think this I think this segues from the last question pretty well, because one of the most frustrating things about working on with Compose outside of with Compose UI is the inability to use it on every platform that it actually can run on without compiling it. You're compiling the runtime for every platform. And then there's also this weird thing with compiler plugins. The compiler plugin that Google publishes only works for Android, JVM, and JavaScript. If you want to, if you actually want to target native targets, you have to compile the compiler yourself. Without like the, there's basically the compiler plugins have to like Jar Jar or Shadow or what's not Shadow. They relocate a few types in the IntelliJ package, but only for the JVM and JS compiler. So like, there's a long way of saying, if I run the team, the thing I would change is to properly publish the compiler so that it works on native targets, and the runtime so that it's compiled for all available Kotlin multi-platform targets. So we do this at work. We compile the project I work on with Compose that's not open source. We compile it for basically every platform that Kotlin multi-platform supports. We're only using it on Android, iOS, and JavaScript for now. But it works like with native Windows or native Linux or whatever. But the problem with this is then it becomes incompatible with other projects. So like one of the things that came out of publishing Molecule was the desire for people to use it on or to use it with Compose Desktop or Compose for Web, which we can do by depending on the JetBrains compiled Compose runtime, but then we create an incompatibility with our own multi-platform Compose runtime for non-Android targets. It's like a mess that I don't want to have to deal with, and I would just love if the runtime, all the sources are in AOSP for JavaScript, for native. They're like in there, they're just not being built and published. When I left, it was because of lack of infrastructure and uncertainty around multi-platform as like a thing to invest in. And so like, that's the thing I really wish would just happen, because it resolves a lot of issues that we're having with multiple non-Compose UI, Compose-based projects interacting with each other. And of course, the downside there is it takes control away from JetBrains a little bit, because they have done a lot of work in that area in order to allow Compose for Desktop and Compose for Web to work. And actually, there's still ongoing work there, because the native code, like JavaScript and actual native code that's sent to LLVM, you have to do things differently in the Compose compiler than what's currently done for JVM. And there's like ongoing work there to improve that and make sure it works correctly. And so like there's more responsibility shifted over to Google for them having to do this, but I think it would greatly simplify the story of a lot of potential Compose-based projects to be open source, because it's kind of a big blocker for like, it's not a blocker for this project that I'm working on at work, because we can just compile it ourselves. But open sourcing it eventually, which we kind of intend to do, becomes harder, because now we have to like fight with the JetBrains runtime, JetBrains Compose runtime, in order to make that work. So yeah, just sort of like stepping up to the plate, acknowledging Kotlin multi-platform is like a thing, going to be a thing, and taking ownership of publishing those artifacts for every available platform.
I think there's the next question is actually a good segue from this one, which is, can you give examples of quality of life improvements that Molecule brings to the table?
It's not necessarily about, so like the thing for us is that we have a real clean layering of our rendering layer, our presenter layer, and our data layer that's below that. And it's enforced through strict interfaces. So like our Compose UI code that we're starting to write, it just cannot reference, like anything coming from like a presenter directly, like the dependencies that a presenter would need in order to display UI data. And so that means that we can't then use Compose to write our write our presenters. Like we currently are just using like RxJava or coroutine flow to, you know, aggregate a bunch of data sources, package them into a nice UI model, ship that UI model to the rendering layer, and then that gets rendered. But that means we lose like all the really nice things that Compose gives you, like being able to write your logic in sort of a regular imperative linear fashion in a function body, instead of like weaving through RxJava operators and sort of hiding your business logic by sprinkling it across like the way that RxJava streams are being combined. Like in Compose, you can just write like an if and an else. And in RxJava, you have to like do a publish to fan out of the stream, do a filter to get your true and your false, then do a map to get your, you know, two code blocks, and then merge those two back together. And you wind up with like 8 lines of code and sort of a bunch of verbosity around what otherwise should just be like, if Boolean, do this, else do this. And so we want the programming model that Compose gives you, but we want it at a layer where we're literally just doing data transformation. We're subscribing to sources of data that are reactive, you know, either observables or flows, and our output is just a single UI model, or really just a stream of UI models. And so Molecule doesn't give you anything that you can't already do today in Compose UI. The difference is that if you have sort of a strict separation where, you know, your presenter code shouldn't really have dependencies on Android UI things, and your Android UI really shouldn't have dependencies on sort of low-level data sources and be performing aggregation. This is like a solution where you can take the same type of code that you would write and move it down a layer. Now, I also will mention, like, we don't use a lot of architecture stuff from Jetpack. So normally, like, I think the way you would do this is have a bunch of stuff in like view models, and your Compose UI code would subscribe or observe or collect, you know, like streams coming from view models. We don't have any of that architecture. Like our architecture is extremely rigid in its definition and what is visible at each layer. And so this is sort of a necessity for us to allow, I mean, I think it allows you to program data, just pure data manipulation in a way that's much more elegant and easy to read. For other people coming in and, you know, trying to understand what a presenter is doing, as opposed to something like, you know, just giant globs of RxJava operators or flow operators. And it's totally, what's also nice is it's actually totally orthogonal to the use of Compose UI. And so today we can allow people to write presenters. We can allow them to change their presenters to be Compose code. And that UI model actually ends up going to an Android.view view tree. And actually those layers don't know anything about each other. So they, you know, you can sort of change them at whim without affecting how the data flows between them. So that's what like it unlocks for us, is the ability to write pure data manipulation code using all the like niceties that Compose adds to the Kotlin language. By sort of removing like the stream boilerplate of data flow and allowing us to just focus on the actual like transformation and logic that's happening.
That's a very good answer. Thank you. Let's get one for Leland. I mean, both of the top upvoted ones are probably for Leland. So, Leland, which one do you prefer? The future spoilers or the performance one? Let's go with the performance one to start.
Okay. I don't have a view of what you're looking at, by the way, so I don't.
Sorry.
Pick whichever one you think is.
Okay. So, how much can we expect Compose performance to improve? Updating lists with med complexity items is notably slower than non-Compose counterpart currently.
Yeah. So how much can we expect performance to improve? Was that?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I think it's especially related to lazy columns and rows, as opposed to recycler views.
Right. I mean, I can tell you what I hope. I don't have. I think there's still a lot of low hanging fruit here, and really like across the whole toolkit. I think that's true. It's as you pick the lowest fruit, the lowest hanging fruit is what was previously the not so low fruit. But for lazy column in particular, there's still some aspects of scheduling that Recycler View does that we haven't really re-implemented yet, that we know has some impact when we do some comparisons. The lazy APIs are doing well in certain situations. But like one of the things is right now, like lazy column is very much geared towards like homogeneous list types, and we, as far as like recycling goes, and there's some mechanisms that I think we could build in so that the reuse is more intelligent based on the actual like list type and like the item type and stuff like that, which I think can have some good benefits. It's kind of weird because the API actually lets you write heterogeneous lists really easily, right? The problem is that the APIs don't really let you specify when a given row is like the same type as another row.
I was just about to ask,
Because of that, any reuse that happens, ends up being sort of lucky, right? Like if the types are the same or not. And there's a way that you could provide hints or declare different item types, which would then let us more intelligently reuse things across when items are, scrolling in and out of the screen. But we didn't deal with that complex case at first, and so there's more work to be done there. There's also lazy column, if you know what subcomposition is, that's a word that sometimes gets thrown around. Basically, each row in a lazy column is a whole new composition than what's happening above it. And so the slot table we were talking about, it's a whole new slot table. And there's some communication happening between those two compositions, which is what makes it like a subcomposition versus just another composition. But right now that's more expensive than it probably should be. And so there's some APIs that we could build that we've talked about building, and will eventually. There's a lot of stuff that we want to do. Right now I feel like there's these two big camps of work. Probably three. There's like build new cool stuff, build the stuff that the Vue toolkit had so that we reach parity, and then there's like make Compose faster. And those three things are all pulling for resources, but we just don't have enough to do all of them at once. And so it's a bit of a push and pull. So anyway, there's APIs that we could build where subcompositions could be dramatically cheaper by essentially, being not as blunt of an instrument, where it's actually utilizing the same, slot table and everything that the parent composition is using. It's just you've just changed some things about that point in composition, which would allow, like, it would get us exactly what subcomposition is getting us right now without the downside. Also, there's like composition as a value, which is something that people may have heard of. We've been talking about it a lot. It's like a fun name for something that doesn't, people don't immediately know what that is, which makes sense. But I probably won't go into like huge details about what that is, but what that would allow us to do also is to like allow for an opt-in API for the lazy list, that you could essentially say, I don't want or need to manage the state of each of these rows independently. Like maybe you're holding the state for each row above the lazy column. And so you're just, you know, you just want to just render it and that's it. And there are things that that we can do to be dramatically more efficient in that case. But that's like that needs to be an additional API, because that would be breaking behavior of the current lazy column, which is that you don't need to worry about state at all. We do essentially the right thing, but the right thing is sometimes not what you need, and it does have overhead. And so, like if you were managing, say, you know, like an address book, you know, like your phone book, where like each row is really just like a name, you know, and like a button, like that's something where you could very easily use this opt-in API, and the performance would be much, much greater. Those are things that come to me. You know, I'm not working directly on the lazy API, so like some other people could probably speak to it more. I mean, I think there's in almost the entire UI toolkit, I mean, there's still just optimizations that can be made. I mean, I often just like, you know, command click into some file, and then I'm like, oh yeah, we probably shouldn't be doing that. Like we could do this more efficiently. And that's just something that's going to come, you know, the toolkit will become more and more mature over time. You know, remember we just went 1.0, you know, this year. And so I think that there is a lot of optimization step in there, and that doesn't even touch on some of the sort of really wide optimizations that I think we can make that are actually more in my camp, which are things that we can do to make the runtime and the compiler better, and it essentially improve performance across the board without changing any implementation at all. And I do think that there's still a lot of low-ish hanging fruit in that department as well, that we just, you know, need more help or more time to get to.
All so, good anyway, things take time. Yeah.
Yeah.
So when you say you need more help, you mean you are hiring?
Well, sometimes I think that we need more help, and then, you know, someone, you know, above me does not. But yeah, actually, I don't know if my team in particular has a job position. We are hiring, but I don't know particularly for that problem. Okay. In particular. You know, we'll see.
Fair enough.
But if you're interested, you know, you can always ping me on Twitter or something.
I appreciate, but I guarantee you I'm not that kind of developer. I cannot do the stuff that you can do. I'm more like, oh yeah, I'm just going to tweet something and mess around with Sebastian on Twitch. So
let's go with another question. We've had a bunch of movement in the questions ranking in the meantime. So the current top question. No. That's not what I meant. A good answer takes time, like everything good. Does recomposition happen on a single thread currently? And since snapshots are isolated from each other, is recomposition on multiple threads possible? Good. Boom. Done. Next one. How should we optimize... yeah, more cores, always good choice. How should we optimize function granularity to improve performance? Basically, should we bother with how big our compose functions are?
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, wait, sorry. There was a problem with mute. You were muted. Leland, do you want to repeat the answer very quickly?
I was muted.
Yeah, no, it's my fault because Skype at some point decided to put all three of you in a single channel. And while I was reading the question, it changed back to everyone in its own channel. So, yeah.
The multi-threaded question?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so the answer was yes and yes. So at the moment, a recomposition happens on a single thread. And we very intentionally built Compose in a specific way to enable multi-threaded composition. And there's actually like multiple ways that you could get multi-threading. See, I'm turning my short answer into a longer one.
I knew I shouldn't ask you to repeat it. I should have just said yes and yes. That's fine.
But so you can, I mean, there's several things that you could do. So we could make it so that, like, for instance, layout and drawing and measuring and all that stuff would happen on one thread, and that the composition could happen on a different thread. And then that would enable, you know, some interesting scheduling opportunities. And you could actually have multiple recompositions for different state changes happening on different threads. And one might win, for instance, like a small state change, like an animation, versus a really big state change, like new data coming in from an API. Those could happen. Those could recompose separately, and then we could display whichever one wins, which will probably be the animation. So there's things like that we could do. But then there's also, for a given recomposition, can we parallelize that at all? And so, like, for disparate recompose scopes that don't touch each other at all, could we recompose those both in separate threads and then recombine the result together? And that's also something that is possible. I mean, there's challenges that come with all of this, and we're trying to figure out what the right way to introduce this type of thing. Also because as soon as you go away from the single threaded world, lots of weird things can happen. And the problem is that they tend to happen to users and not to developers, which makes things, you know, just a whole lot worse. And so we're trying to sort of introduce these things responsibly, and make sure that people understand, you know, how to use them properly.
Got it. I just, given I've seen someone getting started with Compose over the past week or so, I just want to stress that is also why it's really important for you, like, today's still important, but it will be even more important when this happens, that you don't touch global state from within a composable. Because I guess then if you start having multi-threaded code executing and mutation of global state happening while recomposition is happening, that will be problematic. To put it mildly.
It's also side effects as well. Even if you're not going to global state, assuming that because you're able to access something on a view model or source of data does not mean that read will actually be propagated to the UI. And so if you're doing some sort of side effect of incrementing a counter or whatever, that recomposition might get canceled, and you need to wrap that in a side effect blocker. Or put it in, you know, some sort of effect so that it's properly managed by the composition.
Yeah.
I mean, this is whenever you go into a multi-threaded realm, it becomes much more likely that a recomposition happens, but then doesn't actually get reflected on the screen. So we would have to like abort it for some reason or cancel it. And as a result, if you're doing some side effects in your, and I, the naming here is hard. So if you're actually like doing mutations or something during the execution of composition, then that would, you know, potentially be bad. Your data would be in an inconsistent state, which is why we give you these effect APIs so that you can do those things in the effects, because we provide guarantees that those effects only happen if the composition succeeds. And that's why.
Yep. I was fetching the link for the documentation for effects, but I'll do it later. I will, like, again, question ranking has changed, but I started reading a question, so I'll go through with that. how should we optimize function granularity to improve performance? Basically, should we bother how big our Compose functions are? I think a yes or no is fine.
Yeah, I mean, this matters. I don't know how much you should spend your brain power thinking about it, but these are things that you can do to improve performance if performance is a problem. And if you have things that recompose with very different frequencies, so for instance, something that animates and recomposes every frame versus something that, you know, changes maybe once, you know, when the user interacts with it, like, which, you know, happens on the order of, you know, seconds or minutes apart, like those two things, if those are different parts of the hierarchy, but they're in the same function, then, you know, you could be missing an opportunity there. But also remember that, like, most lambdas, when you write, for instance, like button and then you do the trailing lambda syntax, like lambdas are also recomposed scopes. So think of those as functions as well. And so my answer is don't think about it until you measure it, I guess. That would be my answer.
That's fair. I like it.
Next question. There's a lot of activity. Keep the upvotes coming so we can prioritize questions. Because we have another 20 minutes roughly still. So we have a few other questions we can get through. Should we drop fragments now with Compose and just a single activity with Jetpack Compose Navigation?
Well, I mean, if you're starting from like a new app that you can do whatever you want, then I would probably say yes. If you're using fragments for something already, like and they're working for you, like, you know, don't worry about it. Just keep doing what works. These are fairly orthogonal concepts in my mind. So like, I don't think it matters. So just do what is easiest for you to maintain and don't introduce more work to migrate over to Compose than needed. Jake, do you have a different answer? I don't know.
No. I think I am famously a fragment hater, so even if you're not doing Compose UI, you should get rid of fragments.
I mean, that's, I'm in your camp. That's the best thing that happened. The best thing about Compose is that I don't have to care about fragments.
Yeah, I mean, it is a really good, like, so many problems just disappear when you move away from that sort of older architecture that was bolted on and move everything into Compose UI where it's far easier to handle these things because the system, you sort of have this whole system that's designed from scratch for just managing state and things like where you are in a navigational graph, the navigational position of your app is really just state. And so when that state changes, the way you observe it and react to it is, you know, by changing something on the UI. And that's not really meaningfully different than observing, you know, a value of a string that gets displayed in the UI. It's just, you know, a matter of scope and what changes in reaction to it. So I am very happy that Compose UI is becoming this additional reason to migrate away from what is an architecturally questionable library at best.
Opinions not withheld. Next question. What's about using Compose runtimes state objects in architecture layers another than UI, such as presenter, view model, domain, and data? So I think the question is, how about using state objects outside of Compose UI?
I think this is hard for a few reasons that are unfortunate, but I would like it if long-term state became its own library, like for Compose. The fact that it's is included in the Compose runtime is, it's a little bit unfortunate, because it, well, then that, you know, this may just not matter to you, but like, you know, it means that you're, if you wanted to use this in some architectural layer, that you would have to depend on Compose, which is a little bit weird. And it also means that, well, yeah, yeah, you just have to depend on Compose. Using state objects elsewhere, I think there are some kind of gotchas, because, like, well, one is, I would familiarize yourself with the actual snapshot transaction system that mutable state is built on if you're going to do this, because there's lots of good, like, you're kind of losing some of those benefits, because Compose kind of manages some of these things for you. But if you're using them outside, like, you don't have a transaction that you can use and stuff like that. And so without going into what all that is, like, I would just say familiarize yourself with that. And also it's a little bit harder to observe state without using Compose. So, like, if you're observing state somewhere that's not a composable function, there's not great ways to do that right now. I mean, like, you can build like a snapshot flow, which is, you know, but that's like kind of heavy handed. And I mean, so my hesitation with it is that right now you might be locking yourself in to a Compose based UI if you used mutable state in your architecture layer. And I don't know if that's a good idea. But the nice things that state affords you, I think, are good and useful, and we should explore moving that into a world where we can use them in your architectural layer without those concerns. I don't know. That's my answer.
You mean if you're tied to Compose UI as opposed to, I don't know, switching to React Native one day or something?
Well, or... no, I mean, so, like, let's say you're migrating from Views to Compose, like, uh-huh. And then you rewrite your architecture layer to use mutable state. Like, reading that state in your view layer is going to be painful. And mm-hmm. So I don't think that that's a good idea.
Got it.
But I mean, using something like Molecule or something to manage that might be a better option. But I don't know. And that's really using Compose to do these things, which is one of the reasons that it works. But I would like to spend more time exploring what state could be on its own, like, unmarried to Compose. But right now that marriage is still real. So be careful.
It's a happy marriage though. So
yeah, for sure.
There's a question / I guess bug report / feature request, which is, when Compose UI crashes, there are no stack trace mentions of the composable methods being called. What about better error message from Compose crashes?
Well, kind of depends where it crashes. I mean, the stack traces for when you're, I think part of the problem is that when you recompose, the full hierarchy stack trace isn't there. It's only the stack trace of, you know, from the root of the invalid recompose scope, which is shorter. At the end of the day, these are just functions. And so the stack trace that the runtime, provides you is still valid. Like, all of the names of the composable functions are still there, but, you know, exceptions can happen out of band, from when we're actually executing those functions. And so that can be confusing. And then on recomposition, that's also confusing. What I'll say here is that there's like, we have some designs around handling exceptions better in Compose. I don't know if you've noticed, but right now you can't wrap a composable call with try catch. That was explicitly disallowed because if you start thinking hard about it, your mind will start to go crazy. and we want to do it right, but we just didn't know what that was yet. And so eventually that will stop being a compile error, and there will be more well-defined exception handling in composable functions. But that was one of the things that I guess didn't make the 1.0 cut, so to speak. So there's improvements there that we want to do.
Got it. I've never actually tried putting a composable in a try catch. I don't think, like, in my mental model, it made sense. I would rather put a try catch inside of a composable when I'm dealing with code. And like,
yeah.
Well, if the UI crashes, then the problem is something else.
Yeah.
I mean, right now it's really hard for an exception during composition to do anything but fatal. That's okay to a point, but we need to do better than that. It's just takes time to do it right, because it's pretty interesting. Like, if you start thinking about it, like, what do you want to happen when you catch an exception? And
who are you gonna call? So,
yeah.
But actually, I have a very different experience with Compose crashes and, you know, things not working as expected. I also tweeted it a few days ago that I can't even remember which composable I was holding it wrong, and the first time I ran the app crashed, and I checked the log, and there was actually like the perfect explanation: you are doing this wrong, you should be doing this like this. And I was like, okay, wow, that's actually nice. I was like, and I was joking with somebody on Twitter. I was like, the next step is they are just going to point me to the code lab, you know, just like, just go here, learn how to hold it. So I don't know. I feel that this thing never happened to me. Like, you know, I got lost in a stack trace. I had the opposite experience. Like, you know, the thing blew up, and I was like, okay, that's actually how you should be doing it, and it's in the error, right? Like in the log.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's actually nice. And people started to add other examples to my tweet, and I was like, okay, so they have a mindset of helping you. It's just not like, but it's in a very nice way, and not like we were when you forget about adding an activity to the manifest, that, you know, the log cut is very passive aggressive with you. Have you added the activity?
I went, are you sure?
Yeah, if you know that it's not there, why don't you give me a heads up, right? No. You let me crash, and then you said, have you added it? Or like the internet permission, right? It's another one that is always there. Are you sure that the thing is? So, but I really appreciate the errors, actually. So thank you, because that takes a,
you know, effort. The internet permission thing always make me think that Android Studio should have like Clippy that shows up and like, it looks like you're trying to connect to the internet.
See, now that's a good hackathon project. Clippy.
That calls for a plugin.
We'll tell Chris. We'll tell Chris Cinco. No,
I think exception, like error messages, are an incredibly important part of developer experience, but usually underappreciated, underrated in terms of the people writing the thing. And so some people are really thoughtful, and those are probably the people that wrote the messages you're talking about. I think it's an important thing to focus on. And the answer that I gave is more about this sort of more fundamental question of like, what do exceptions mean in a composable function? And we're trying to come up with a solid answer for that.
Almost getting into the philosophy of what happens when. I think we have time for maybe one or two other questions. Let's go with the current top one. What is the future around tooling for Compose? And I would like to hear not just Leland's answer, but maybe if Jake is also thinking about some wacky side project as well.
Sure, confidence.
Bright. there's one answer.
Wow.
One word.
Clippy. Answer. Clippy. Yeah.
Clickly. Now you put the thing on the table. Sebastian, you put the thing on the table. Now it's happening.
I'll just say I care a lot about tooling, and I'd like to spend more time working on tooling directly for Compose. But I think there is, that's like the long tail, you know, like, I mean, there is going to be a lot of work spent on building the right tools for Compose. And personally, I think that is like what's going to make the difference between Compose just being good versus great. And I think we have yet to deliver there, but I think the future is bright. And I can't speak to specific things that we're working on, but I'm excited for a lot of them.
Nice. That's good. Thanks.
Jake?
Yeah, for me, I don't know what my... I think I think there's still a large amount of Compose that you really have to internalize to get correct. One of the things that just scares me a bit about introducing something like Molecule is the ability for somebody to access a stream, you know, like coming from the database or whatever, apply a normal operation on that, like a map operation, and then call collect as state or subscribe as state if it's RxJava. And this is actually like, it's incorrect, because what's going to happen is your function's going to recompose, and it's basically going to run that code again. It's going to get a new instance back from the map function that's not the same as the previous one, and it's going to unsubscribe from your old stream and resubscribe to your new stream. And this is something that happens like completely transparently. You're unaware that this is happening.
I've done that several times.
Yeah, visually you might catch it depending on the source of your data, where like if there's a initial default value coming out, you might see that for a frame before it flips back to the real data or whatever. But it's examples like that where it's really that is a very specific example of the this mental model you need to build of just like this function is executing. It's not really, but it's executing, you know, 60 frames a second. And so every piece of code in there has to really be thoughtfully written in a way that if it's doing an operation that really should only happen once or based on some other event, there's probably a Compose API that you need to hook into in order for it to not happen, you know, 60 times. It's not really, again, 60 times a second, but not every time the function is recomposed. And the problem with that is like, how do you build something that makes developers aware of that? Because it's just like a refactoring foot gun. It's very easy for somebody else somebody to write it correctly, where you're just like, you know, my data collect as state, and to have somebody else come in and just be like, oh, I need to, you know, prepend a label or something to this and just put a map operator in mm-hmm. between those two, thinking that they've done the correct thing. And so like, how do you prevent things like that? So it really is like the Clippy thing where, Rust has a tool called Rust Clippy, which really is for these kinds of things where it's like, I know what you're trying to do, but here's what you actually need to do. And it doesn't actually fail. You can make it fail your build by default. And, you know, it's basically just like a superpowered lint. But it's stuff like that where I really would like to see the tooling step up is helping you to create the correct patterns to ensure that you're, you know, going to have success with what you're trying to do. Because no matter what, like, this is a powerful and somewhat complex tool, and making it appear as simple as possible is certainly a goal. But I think there's always going to be things that you really need to have sort of your hand held and really internalize what's going on under the hood in order to avoid a pattern like that.
Yeah, I think there's like two different directions to attack this problem. There's like preventing you from shooting yourself in the foot. So, you know, however that may happen, like, you know, design better APIs that prevent it, you know, lint warnings, like those types of things. And then there's like, how do you make people realize that their foot is bleeding as quick as possible? You know, like, it's like, yeah, oh, you shot yourself in the foot, but maybe I didn't realize that until months down the road. And so, like, how do we go from months to, you know, the very next time the application ran or something? And and if you know that, you know, there's some hemorrhage somewhere on your body, like, how do you find it really quickly? Like, how do you build tools that help you find the things that are behaving differently from how you expected as quick as possible? And I think we need to improve both of those stories right now.
Yeah, I think on this specific issue, I think latest version of Studio, or maybe, I don't know if it's Bumblebee or Chipmunk, added a lint check for that, at least for flow operators, will tell you, hey, you're probably doing the wrong thing. I guess that's the general direction where you need Clippy or whatever to point at you that maybe what you're trying to do, you're trying to do it in the wrong way. Like, your heart is in the right place. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. And by the way, like, if you're in, you know, the audience, like, listening to this, and you have like some moment where you did something like that, you know, you wrote something that you thought was, you know, very straightforward, but like it ended up being a very bad thing, you know, let us know about those things, because I think it's important for us to know what are the common mistakes that people are, like, the foot guns that people are running into, so that we can design APIs to prevent them. We can write lint rules to you know, warn against them. We can, you know, become more aware of, like, what's actually happening to people on the ground more often.
So we have 3 minutes until Jake has to run. So I think it's time to wrap it up. We have a ton of other questions. I'm very aware of that. Maybe we can have you back at some point, and we'll save the questions on some Google Doc, and we can go through the other ones as well, if you'd like. More than happy to have you back, as always, because we love all our guests. For today, I really want to thank you both. As always, a lot of insights and really useful information about Compose and the internals of Compose, which is what we're here for, really, learning new things. So thank you to both Leland and Jake. Thank you very much. Evan, you have 60 seconds to do your thing.
I have a winner for the giveaway. So congratulations, the Solel Shaikh.
Congratulations.
Probably butchered your knee. Congratulations. I send you a friend request, and I'm going to reach out for your address to send you stickers. So congratulations again. Thank you for being with us. And the VOD is going to be ready right away. If you are a subscriber, you can go back and check the questions and the answers. If you are on YouTube, it's going to be available for from tomorrow evening. So thank you for the support. And subscribe if you can. If you can.
Bye. Thank you, everyone. Have a good one. Bye.
Ciao. Thanks, guys.